I definitely felt like I was in danger of being beaten up, though. This crowd was not having me there at all. They didn't care what I was there for. They didn't care that I was trying to tell the story from all sides. They just wanted me out of the area.
Joining me now is our very own Daily Caller reporter, Shelby Talcott. Shelby, long time no see. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
And for those of you watching, please don't forget to like and subscribe to the Daily Caller. Now, Shelby, I watched some videos. You are in D.C., and you were at the protest at Lafayette Park, right across the street from the White House. There was a lot going on. It looked like you were harassed by protesters. You were even attacked by protesters. What happened?
Yeah, so we were down there reporting. They were trying to take down a statue earlier in the evening. They weren't successful. Police came and sort of pushed them back. But as the night went on, these protesters, or a small group of them at least, became pretty annoyed that I was filming. They told me to stop filming, and then one of them accused me of being an undercover cop. I'm not entirely sure where that allegation came from, but it stuck. The mob started, you know, repeating that I was a cop. I tried to tell them that I was a reporter, and long story short, the situation quickly escalated. One of the protesters or rioters in this group grabbed my phone. They started circling me. I got pushed around, and eventually the police actually pulled me from the crowd to prevent it from escalating even further.
That must have been terrifying. And as you know, a lot of us that work at the Daily Caller, we attend these protests, and they get pretty heated, and you see people getting attacked, and also just being surrounded by protesters who either know who you are, know the news organization that you work for, or they just don't like that you're out there, and you feel surrounded and you feel helpless. Did you feel like you were, your life was in danger, or did you feel that police had a good handle of what was going on around you?
So it definitely helped, because I sort of caught eyes with three other male coworkers that were also on the ground in the vicinity. So I knew that if push came to shove and the police didn't intervene, I would have them there to back me up, which was really helpful. And so I definitely felt like I was in danger of being beaten up, though. This crowd was not having me there at all. They didn't care what I was there for. They didn't care that I was trying to tell the story from all sides. They just wanted me out of the area.
Well, and wasn't there just like pepper spray in the air? Didn't some of our coworkers get hit in the face with pepper spray?
Yeah, earlier in the night, our coworker, Rich McGinnis, got hit, I think, directly in the face with pepper spray.
From who?
He wasn't crying, but he was, so.
He was crying?
Yeah, he was tearing up a bit, for sure.
I mean, that it's absolutely to get hit in the face with pepper spray. Where did the pepper spray come from, do you know?
The police were pepper spraying protesters who were these protesters were aggressively going after the police. It wasn't one of those situations where police were moving forward, protesters were moving back. It was police were moving forward, protesters were also moving forward towards the police. So the officers started spraying people using their batons.
How did Richie get caught in the middle of that?
He was right there in the middle reporting and recording. And I think it was just bad luck where one of the protesters in front of him started going after an officer, and he was, you know, wrong place, wrong time.
Yikes. So in the video, I heard you telling the protesters, hey, I'm a journalist, I'm trying to do my job. And they didn't seem to care. And these protesters are all about the First Amendment, right? They're there to assemble peacefully. Yet, in these videos, they didn't look very peaceful. Yet, they won't let you do your job. So they don't respect the First Amendment in that sense.
Yeah, I found I've done a fair bit of these protests now. And I found that there's always a group of protesters who are trying to keep the peace. There was a guy there who saw I was wearing an Iowa tennis shirt. And he was sort of like, oh, you're from Iowa. Okay, guys, she's fine. She's a reporter. But I find that even with those peaceful protesters, it only takes, you know, one or two who don't want to listen and who don't want you to be there. And I think that's quite interesting because they are supposedly for, you know, free speech and stuff, but it seems like they're, some of them at least, are only for free speech if it's what they agree with, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's rather curious that they would be so upset that they're being filmed even though they're at a very public protest, and you have all the right in the world to film whatever is going on in that park. And also, these people should know that their identities aren't going to be hidden, and the people who are trying to steal your cell phone and push you around, like, they should know that it's everything that they're doing, everyone can see.
Yeah, and I explained that. I said, you know, we're in a public area. I have the right to film. I'm also a reporter, so it's my job. They came back at me saying, no, you're wrong, which wasn't a great argument and was wrong on their end. And the other thing was, all of these people were wearing masks. Actually, one woman who was getting in my face had an entire hockey face mask on, so you couldn't see these people anyway. If I am recording, it's not like they're walking around like you and I are talking right now with no masks on. So
I remember you telling me that you actually got handcuffed by police. So you said that the police ended up helping you get away from this crowd, because at the end of the video, which we don't see, is when the protesters start getting really rough with you and police grab you, pull you in, and then they handcuffed you. So I'm kind of confused how you ended up in handcuffs.
I'm also still a little bit confused on that. So when the fight started, I believe one of my coworkers actually pushed me into the police line, hoping that they would intervene, and they did. And then as soon as I was kind of in a little ball because I was trying not to get beaten, and I felt myself being dragged through the police line. I looked up, I was very shaken, and then two officers came and grabbed my backpack off my back, started putting my hands behind my back, slapped handcuffs on. I asked them, you know, why am I being handcuffed? They said, you were in a fight, we're detaining you, it's for your own protection, we're not arresting you. I have to admit, I was very, you know, I think tensions were high. The police officers were having some words with me, I was having words back with the officers, but ultimately, maybe it's protocol if you're behind the police line to have handcuffs on. You know, they didn't know me, I'm not sure, but they did escort me with handcuffs on for about 5 minutes to a separate area where they then released me.
Were you there when the protesters were trying to pull down this Andrew Jackson monument? That video, my jaw dropped when I saw that. I couldn't believe it. And I'm just thinking, this is, you know, our city, our town. This is where we live. This is where we work. They don't have the right to pull down these monuments and statues and put graffiti all over our beautiful city.
I came shortly after they were trying that. So I arrived when the police had just arrived and were pushing them back. One of our coworkers was there on the ground while they were trying to topple it down. They weren't successful, but they did manage to vandalize the structure. They also put graffiti on St. John's Church, which is just across the street in Lafayette Square. So they did manage to do that, but didn't manage to successfully topple over the statue.
And you have to wonder where the mayor of D.C. is, why, and I get that police intervened, but this was going on for a while, and this is right in front of the White House. I mean, it's just you steps away from the White House, and it's hard to believe that this is happening and that it's even going this far.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, you see it all over the country. We have Seattle, where we were just last week, which has its own autonomous zone. Protesters actually last night tried to set up an autonomous zone in D.C. They called it the Black House Autonomous Zone. I don't think that was incredibly successful, but they were making strides to do so. I think they had one in another city as well. So it's going on all over the country. There's the civil unrest is often turning into, you know, more violent protests. So
you've been covering these protests in D.C. Are they getting bigger? Are more people participating? Or as in D.C., you'll see the protests, they're huge and there's thousands of people, and then the crowds start to thin out over time.
I would say that's the case. Yesterday, the crowd was far smaller than, you know, the first weekend of protests in D.C. We saw thousands of people gathering. So it seems to be a smaller group now, but this group has sort of hunkered down. They're protesting every day.
Well, Shelby, thank you so much for sharing your terrifying experience out there. You're so brave. I know a lot of reporters wouldn't want to go out there because of all of the risk involved with being there, from pepper spray to the violence to losing your personal objects. So good reporting, and we're looking forward to more reports from you. I'm assuming you're still going to go out. This isn't going to deter you from covering protests.
Yeah, I'll continue to be going out. I'll just, try to be a little bit more incognito next time. So
maybe wear a GoPro or something.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Shelby.
Thanks.